Welcome. Today we're going to start a new unit. This is kind of a mini unit that's going to give us a chance to kind of get ourselves ready for our next unit, Unit 3. And this is just going to kind of be an introduction to that. But this unit is going to discuss a topic that you have learned in Chemistry 1. It's going to give you a chance to review it, give you a chance to kind of make sure you feel comfortable with the calculations related to it, as well as the concepts. So if you haven't already, I'm going to ask that you take about 5 minutes, and if you would read the slide in front of you, this starter, and go ahead and draw the pictures and write out the questions and all of that, and then see if you could answer it. So go ahead, take about 5 minutes, pause the video so that you can look at this, and then see if you could answer these questions based on your prior knowledge of gas laws. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at these two pictures and see if we can use our knowledge that we have of gas laws, or knowledge that you have of gas laws from Chemistry 1, to answer the questions in these two pictures. So let's just start with question number one. Says, assuming the connecting tube has negligible volume, draw what each diagram would look like after the stopcock between the two flasks is open. Now, just really quickly, so what this is saying is, if this volume right here doesn't matter, and this is what the stopcock is, that's what prevents this gas from getting over here. If it opens up and this gas starts moving over in both of these pictures, what should both of the pictures look like? So as we picture it, let's just say with this one, if the gas starts to move over there, then what should start to happen is what? Well, in order to picture, I'm going to go ahead and move this onto a black screen and draw it for you. Picture, so this is the first one, and this is the second one. Then the big thing we should notice is that in both of them, they should have equal amounts of particles. So in the end, it should end up looking something like this. Now, alright, so I'm also going to label what else it said. It told us that the volume of this side was actually 2x versus x, and then for each of these, it's labeled that the volumes were x. So that's just some basic information that we were given from this picture. And this is basically after or over time what our two pictures of gases should look like. So we should end up having equal amounts of gases on both sides, assuming that, you know, that it's open, and like it said, that the actual area in the middle is negligible. So then the question becomes from that, because that's not all that was asked, the next question says, or asks you to consider what their pressures would look like. So if you were going to solve for their final pressure based solely what you're seeing in this picture, what would you write? So let's remember something, because as you remember, in Chemistry 1, you learned several formulas, and one of those formulas dealt with pressure. It looks something like this, P1 V1 equals P2 V2. You might even be able to think of a lot of other formulas, right? Like, for example, we learned about pressure and volume. We learned about volume and temperature, just to name a few. You might even remember the combined gas law, which was P1 V1 over T1 equals P2 V2 over T2, and so on. In just a minute, I'm going to show you a whole list of those formulas. But for right now, we're just dealing with the formula between pressure and volume. So the question is, if you were to solve for the final pressure of these gases, so once the stopcock was open, what was the final pressure of these gases? What would it look like? Well, let's just picture. So if we're given that the volume is this, so volume is 2x, volume is x, we could say something like this, that we don't know P1, V1 we're told is 2x, we don't know P2, but V2, we're told, is x. So let's just isolate this to see what it would look like if we were trying to solve for P2. So we don't know P1, but we do know that V1 is 2x. We don't know P2, but we do know that V2 is x. So if we were going to isolate for P2, we'd end up dividing both sides by x. And we get that 2 times P1 is P2. So all that's really telling us, think about what this is saying, because this is really just solving for X. This is just practicing the ideas or things that you would have learned in, you know, algebra. But all this is really saying is that the pressure in the second volume, so the pressure in here is double the pressure in where? The pressure in there, which the question is, does that make sense? Does it make sense that the pressure in this smaller area is double the pressure in this larger area? And you should say yes, right? Because the area is smaller, which means the particles are closer together, which means they're going to hit or collide a whole lot more often. The same idea for the second picture. Now, I rewrote this a little bit for you just so you'd have a clearer idea, but let's just consider. So again, if we're still considering the same concept, so P1 V1 equals P2, V2, and we know that we don't know P1, nor do we know P2, right? But our question asks us to solve or isolate as if we were solving for P2. We do know V1 is X. We do know V2 is also X because they're the same size, right? So notice that this is telling us that in this picture over here that the volume was twice as big, which then makes sense as to why when we talked about the pressure, that the pressure of P2 was 2 times as much. All right, so here, if the volumes are the same, we've got P1 times X for V1 equals P2 times X for V2. So really, if we were to isolate or try to solve for P2, we just get that P2 and P1 are the same. So, if the volume is the same, well then the pressure is same too. But we saw over here that because the volume of that one was 2 times as much, the pressure of this one was 2 times as much, right? And that goes back to our idea of the relationship between the two. All right, so let's consider that, and let's go back and think about some of the things that we know related to gases, and that brings us to what we call the kinetic theory. Now, you already have this written down, but let me just remind you of a few things. Remember that gases consist of tiny particles, right? We know that. They're in constant continuous random motion, right? So these gas particles, they're constantly moving. We know their motion is random. We also know that the distance is large compared to the size of the particles, right? And that's because gases are mostly empty space. We know that in ideal kinetic theory, which, if you remember, we oftentimes then refer to that as the idea of the ideal gas law, that gas molecules will have no attraction for one another, right? That they'll move independent of each other is the way you probably heard it in Chemistry 1. Again, this is only ideally. And also that because they're moving independently of each other, they have no attraction, they'll be moving in straight lines in all directions, colliding with each other and the walls of their containers, right? So they're constantly moving, they have a lot of space between them, they're not attracted to each other, they're hitting other things, right? They're hitting each other and their surroundings. Remember that their collisions are elastic. Remember that all that really means is that they're perfect, right? So there's no energy lost in the collision. It's a ball hits another ball and all the energy is transferred between the two, right? So there's no loss of energy, which again goes back to the idea of them being ideal gases. And then lastly, we know that their kinetic energy is the same at the same temperature. So kinetic energy equals, if you will, the temperature, which means what? As the kinetic energy increases, the temperature increases and vice versa, right? And that's it. If we understand those concepts of the kinetic theory and the idea of gases, then that gives us all these formulas that we learned in Chem 1. Now, as you were asked to copy down this PowerPoint, you probably went through and remembered some of these formulas, like Boyle's Law. You probably even remember doing some calculations with them. You might have touched a little bit on Gay-Lussac's Law, which really is just pressure and temperature versus pressure and volume, or volume and temperature. And then, for sure, you definitely looked at, in Chem 1, the combined law, right, which just considers pressure, volume, and temperature, all of them. So it shows how pressure, volume, and temperature are related. Now, you could even solve that in terms of density, which is not overall important unless you were given a calculation, which very rarely happens. But occasionally, you might be asked something related to density. And then from that, remember that we get the ideal gas law. And that's where we're going to move towards as we really start looking at these gases in the next week. Now, there's other formulas that you're going to need to know that we're going to be looking at. One of them listed on here, Graham's Law. We're going to look at that on Wednesday and Thursday of this week, as well as the partial pressures, which again is another one that most definitely you learned in Chem 1. You might have not done a whole lot with, but you will be asked to do some stuff with it in this class. But let's just focus on a few of your practice problems. Now, my plan for this week is to go through a few of the practice problems each day from your packet, but I'm not going to go over all of them. I'm only going to touch on a few, and then I'm going to ask you to use your knowledge, your understanding of gas laws, to see if you could answer some of the others. Now, as you do that, if you should have a question about how you did on one, please feel free to send it to me or message me, but otherwise, you can come in on Thursday after school and ask questions as well. You will take a quiz over this for a grade on Monday of next week, and you're going to be taking a practice quiz at the end of this week to see what you know and to see what questions you have and all of that. But let's just take a look at one. So let's go ahead and look at number one on our practice problem packet. So number one, it had said this, and you can just follow along, and maybe you've already done number one. And if you had this, great. If you haven't, just go ahead and take a look at it now, and we can discuss it together. So number one says a sample of SF6 occupies a container of variable volume. If the sample originally occupies a volume of 50 milliliters at 755 millimeters mercury, calculate the pressure which must be exerted to lower the volume to 25 milliliters. Now, I'm going to give you about 5 minutes. You can pause the video if you want to, but if you haven't done this practice problem, see if you could solve the practice problem solely based on the knowledge you have of the formulas that you've used either in this class, seen in this class, or seen in chemistry one. So go ahead and take 5 minutes, see if you could solve this problem. Okay, so let's go ahead and take a look at this problem based on the information we have. I would suggest to you or recommend to you that the very first thing you do in doing any practice problems related to the idea of gas laws, and you can always know it's related to gas laws because it will talk to you about information where you'll see things like a sample of a substance. It'll give you things like units. It might include things like millimeters of mercury, which is really just a unit for pressure. And you'll see things like volume, and it'll ask, you know, based on starting with this and having this, you know, how much do you have in the end? And so always look for keywords that will lead you into understanding what exactly the problem is asking for. But let's just look at this. It says a sample of SF6 occupies a container of variable volume. So in other words, the container, by saying variable volume, all that really means is it's saying that the container can expand. All right, so it's an expanding container. If the sample originally, all right, so you think originally, that would be like saying initial or to begin with, occupies a volume of 50 milliliters, right? So if we say originally, we have this, it's like saying V1 is 50 milliliters at 755 millimeters of mercury. So what is that? All that really is just a pressure. So if this is our V1, 50 milliliters, our P1 is 755 millimeters of mercury. All right, it says calculate the pressure which must be exerted to lower the volume to 25 milliliters. Notice it says we're lowering the volume to reach this, right? So in the end, our V2 is 25 milliliters. The question is, what is our pressure, right? So we could call that P2. All right, so based on that information, based on what we're given, we're being asked between pressure and volume, and the only formula we have that relates only pressure and volume is P1 V1 equals P2 V2. So let's plug in what we know. P1 is 755 millimeters of mercury. Again, all that really means is just a unit for pressure. V1 is 50 milliliters equals P2, which we don't know, but we do know V2 is 25. And now we solve, right? We just isolate our variable for P2. So let's divide both sides by 25 milliliters. And when we do that, we get what? Take a minute and plug those numbers in and see what you get. All right, and when we plug that in, you should get the following. You should get 1510 millimeters of mercury. So 1510 millimeters of mercury. Now, you might look at the variable and you might be like, well, I don't really know what millimeters of mercury means. Well, generally speaking, when we talk about pressure, we talk about it in terms of atmospheres. That's probably what you remember. And remember that sea level we consider to be one atmosphere. As we go above sea level, then we know that it starts to get lower, so we get fewer atmospheres. As we go below, then we start to get more atmospheres, more pressure. All right, and you probably even heard that, right? That as you go up, let's say onto like the top of a mountain, you're going to find that the pressure up there is a whole lot less than as you go down below, or below sea level, if you will. All right, so with that in mind, one atmosphere would be like saying 760 millimeters of mercury. It's kind of like a relationship, right? We could technically, if we wanted to, use dimensional analysis to go from millimeters of mercury to atmospheres. And if you wanted to, you could do that, but you don't have to. You could just leave it as this. So the final pressure is 1510. Now I want you to think about that value and think about what we talked about on the previous slide, right? So we had said if you double the volume, you have half the pressure and vice versa, right? So what we're seeing here is simply by decreasing the volume in half, we have double the pressure. All right, so let's look at another one. Let's look at question number three. Question number three in your packet. And let's go ahead and see what that question is asking. So it says, a 545 milliliter sample of nitrogen gas initially at 220 degrees Celsius is heated to 100 degrees Celsius. Calculate the new volume, assuming the pressure does not change. So let's talk now about the information we have, and let's see if we could go about solving this problem. Now I'm going to go ahead and work through this one with you, just because there might be a few things that you might not consider that I want to make sure you feel comfortable with, and so let's just go ahead and look at this. So let's just start with the very first thing it asks. A 545 milliliter sample of nitrogen gas. Milliliters, right off the bat, that tells us we're talking about volume. And it tells us that initially has a temperature of 220 degrees Celsius. Now that word initially means that this is the volume. We could even call this V1. Then this is T1. And then it says is heated to 100 degrees Celsius, which means that's the end. So T2, notice what it says. Calculate the new volume, right? New volume. So that would be V2, assuming the pressure does not change. So based on the information we have, we're asking about volume and pressure. And we see from our formulas dealing with volume and pressure. And if you need to look back at your slides or think back, or maybe you just already remember them, and that's great if you do, the formula is V1 over T1 equals V2 over T2. Alright, but before we do anything, it's important that you note something. And this is actually in your packet. It's also in your slides. And you might even remember this from Chemistry 1. But when dealing with temperature, temperature must be in Kelvin. Alright? So in order to solve for temperature, you've got to have it in Kelvin. Now to picture why, it's because degrees Celsius has no zero, as in no ending point. Now you could say, well, it's 0 degrees Celsius, but technically that's not zero, right? You can actually go below 0 degrees Celsius. So because because degrees Celsius has no ending point, you need it to be in Kelvin. Kelvin can be zero, right? Kelvin as zero, or zero Kelvin, is what we call absolute zero. And if you remember, at absolute zero, matter would cease to exist. It wouldn't have any energy, and so basically the particles would stop moving. So absolute zero is just a theoretical idea of temperature, but that would be like the ending point. So we need temperature to be in Kelvin. Now, to remind you, if you're trying to get temperature into Kelvin, you're simply going to take your degrees Celsius plus 273. So let's go ahead and do that for our temperatures. So for our T1, which is 220 plus 273, and we get 493 Kelvin. Let's also do that for our T2. So for our T2, same idea. All right, let's go ahead and do that for our T1. So for our T1, remember that we had negative 220 degrees Celsius plus 273, which means our T1 is 53 Kelvin. Now we could do the same thing for our T2. So our T2, which was, 100 degrees Celsius plus 273, and we get that our T2 was 373 Kelvin. All right, so let's go back and let's plug in our information to solve for what it asked for. Now remember, the question said, calculate the new volume, right? So we're trying to solve for V2. We've got the information we need to do that. So let's think about what we know. V1 tells us is 545 milliliters. T1, we now know, because we just converted it to Kelvin, is 53 Kelvin. T2 we now know, right? Because again, we converted that to Kelvin. So 373 Kelvin, and V2 is what we're solving for. So let's plug in our numbers. V1, 545 milliliters over our T1, which is 53 Kelvin, equals V2. We don't know it. Over our T2, which is 373 Kelvin. All right, we need to isolate our variable for V2, so we're going to do that by multiplying both sides by 373, and we get that V2 is 3,840 milliliters. And that's it. A couple things to notice. So one, it's a really large value compared to our initial value, but notice that our temperature increased a whole lot, right? So we increased the temperature and we also increased the volume, which makes sense because of our equation. V1 over T1 equals V2 over T2. And that's it. As you're looking at these, I did do number 1 and number 2 for you, or 3 for you, I'm sorry. I encourage you to go back and look at number 2 as well as number 4. They deal with some of this pressure and volume and temperature. Then they also combine to produce what we call the combined gas law. If you should have any questions, please don't hesitate to ask. Otherwise, tomorrow we're going to start looking at these a little bit more as we discuss what we call the ideal gas law.